Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, I extend a very warm welcome to you to the International Peace Institute in New York on this, the International Day of Peace. I cannot think of a better way to mark this day than to launch a peace map at the International Peace Institute. It is our pleasure at the IPI to host this event on how interreligious dialogue can strengthen resilience and contribute to sustainable peace. In today's world, where we see so many conflicts and tensions, interreligious dialogue has an important role to play in building understanding, trust, and peace. We are all looking forward to the visit of His Holiness Pope Francis to the United Nations General Assembly this coming Friday. Most interreligious dialogue is unseen. What we often hear about is religion as a source of conflict, but we hear very little about the role of religion as a force for peace. I therefore look forward to the map that will be unveiled here today that showcases the work of several hundred organizations around the world that are engaged in interreligious dialogue. Here at the IPI, we analyze normally the drivers of conflict. We see in so many different cases that so-called religious or ethnic conflicts are a result of a cocktail of many factors, of which ideology, at least in the early stages, plays only a minor role. To understand why crises erupt, we must know what makes societies or communities vulnerable. Is it demography, inequality, injustice, exclusion from public institutions and services? By better understanding risk and vulnerability, steps can be taken to strengthen resilience. In a world which is increasingly adrift, where extremism and violence continue to thrive, interreligious dialogue is an important vehicle towards constructing a counter-narrative that promotes peace, justice, and equality. In addition to the technicalities of coding and production, IPI's contribution to the peace map has been to identify risk factors and to highlight themes and trends that can have an impact on peace, security, and development. This information has been overlaid by a map showing several hundred organizations engaged in interreligious dialogue around the world. It is a great example of visualizing risk and resilience. Ladies and gentlemen, next week there will be a Millennium Summit that across the street at the UN on the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development. That agenda clearly emphasizes the importance of cooperation between all stakeholders to achieve the Sustainable Development Goals. The peace map shows that there are already 400 organizations working towards those common goals. I therefore commend the King Abdullah bin Abdulaziz International Center for Interreligious and Intercultural Dialogue for taking the bold decision to create a peace map. I would also like to take this opportunity to convey to colleagues who are here from CAISED, also on behalf of the President of the IPI, Terje Rod Larsen, our strong support for CAISED's work in promoting dialogue, cooperation, reconciliation, and peace. We look forward to hearing more about your activities, and we look forward to the panel discussion that will be moderated by Mohammed Abu Nimer, who is Director of the Peace Building and Development Institute at the American University and a Senior Director at CAISED. Before I turn the floor over to Dr. Abu Nimer, it is my great pleasure and honor to introduce Metropolitan Emmanuel, Exarch of the Ecumenical Patriarchate of Constantinople. Metropolitan Emmanuel is a member of the board of CAICED, and among his many distinguished functions, he has been co-president of the World Conference of Religions for Peace and president of the Conference of European Churches. Sir, the floor is yours.
Your Excellencies, ambassadors and members of the diplomatic corps, ladies and gentlemen, today, on International Peace Day, we are faced with great challenges to peace than we have seen in the past quarter century. Yet, we can be more hopeful than ever before that we can achieve sustainable peace through new innovative strategies. At this event, you will see that our center, International Center for Interreligious and Cultural Dialogue, CAICED, peace map that displays expanding global networks. These networks enable on-site peace that is helping communities to reconcile animosities in the face of conflict. The innovative dimension the peace map makes visible in the composition of these networks. And they are more diverse and numerous than probably expected by most of us. They represent new collaborative relationships between intergovernmental, national, civil society, and religious organizations. These are networks that promote interreligious dialogue. And this map shows that such dialogue is much more than talk. It means action. Ladies and gentlemen, I believe that these growing networks demonstrate the new consciousness, shape our approach to building peace. Religious communities' contributions to building peace at the grassroots level and policymaker level are much more than complementary. Rather, they are vitally necessary to building peace. The reason is demographics. Although statistics differ, somewhere between 50 to 80% of the world's population describe themselves as having a religious identity. When people identify themselves with religions, religious values and tenets, an enormous force for good can be called upon. These communities can support each other through mutual respect, and they help preserve pluralism and diversity, and they can and will strongly encourage peaceful coexistence in the decades to come. In short, religious communities are compassionate and loving communities that reject hate speech, stereotyping, racism, exclusion, and violence in the name of religion. We go beyond the tolerance because we need a community that shows love to the other. Yes, religion is often seen as a source of a problem. As many of us know from a troubling experience, religion is deliberately misused to foment conflict. I do remember in the years of 90s when we had a war in the former Yugoslavia, and we mentioned many occasions that the war in the Balkans was not about religion. But unfortunately, the image that you have and we had it was different. The vast majority of the followers of any religion are peaceful. Their belief is more than an identity. It is an inspiration, a motivation, and an enabler of active support for caring communities. In some regions, it is the religious communities and faith-based organizations that deliver a growing percentage, sometimes most, of the vital community services, such as education and healthcare. It is these services that underpin sustainable peace. As a board member of the International Center in Vienna, as I said, CAICID, a core priority for us, for the center, is to bring policymakers and leaders of religious communities together to construct solutions to contemporary challenges. The center began in 2014 to build a unified, inclusive coalition of religious leaders to unite against the violence in the name of religion. We were driven by the crisis mainly in Iraq and Syria. Since then, we have had collaborations with UNESCO, the UN Secretary General, Special Advisor on the Prevention of Genocide, the UNDP, the OIC, and ISESCO to convene religious leaders and policymakers primarily in the region of Middle East and Africa. Ladies and gentlemen, one of the gravest challenges to peace and human dignity that we face today is still the crisis in the Middle East. And we know it very well. We need to combat what is there and what causes all the trouble. 2 weeks ago, in Athens, we had the privilege of organizing with the International Dialogue Center in the Ecumenical Patriarchate under the auspices of the Hellenic Ministry of Foreign Affairs, our third major event, a meeting of religious leaders and experts from the Middle East. And in Athens once more, the high-level Orthodox, Catholic, Coptic, Druze, Shia, and Sunni religious leaders resolved together to engage political leaders to take a strong stand against growing violent extremism and terrorism. This violence threatens centuries of peaceful coexistence in the Middle East. And beyond their joint advocacy, the religious leaders pledged to support proactive efforts to stern attempts to segregate religious communities and foster conflict. This dialogue initiative is a further example of collaboration between governmental and religious leaders. Just last week, we conducted the Amman Social Media Training Program entitled Social Media as a Space for Dialogue in Amman, in Jordan. And this project gathered a diverse group of 110 trainees from the Middle East, the MENA region, and gained a noticeable media coverage. The project aimed for four main outcomes. First, a training manual was tested. Second, 10 campaign ideas were developed with an immediate follow-up plan. Three, we are in the process of developing a follow-up concept from Al-Azhar. And finally, four guidelines for using social media as a space for dialogue were produced. Ladies and gentlemen, in closing these short remarks, I wish to emphasize that hundreds of thousands of Christians, Muslim, and other religious and ethnic groups have already been subjected to horrible violence and persecution. If action is not taken now, the vibrancy and diversity of communities in the region will be lost forever. Yet, if we work together to use interreligious dialogue, now we can preserve diversity and reconcile communities. I trust that the Qaisid peace map will help the international community in quickly expanding its existing collaborative work with many organizations that promote dialogue internationally, whether they be religious, governmental, or civil society, to help counterbalance the present flood of extremism and speed the collaboration necessary to rebuild diversity of communities that have coexisted mostly peacefully in this region for centuries. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Eminence. Good afternoon. Again, my name is Mohammed Abu Nimer. I'm a professor of the Peace and Conflict Resolution at American University and a senior advisor at Qaisid for the last year and a half. Again, I welcome all of you and thank you for joining us in this important day for Qaisid work, as well as, of course, International Peace Day, as has been mentioned before by our two esteemed colleagues here in the introduction. Before we yield the floor to Patrice, I'm worried that we'll have two seats here, and when you're going to present, we might block that. So I'm going to ask the two other speakers who will comment on it, Dr. Azza Karam. And you have the biography of the two speakers there, so I'm not going to bore you reading them. And I think you'll have the details there, and also Dr. Pedersen as well. But before I give the floor to Patrice, I'd like to recommend 4 points for you to consider while you listen to the presentation of the and the launching of the peace mapping. First of all, why we do this, or what are the consequences, what we hope to accomplish from this. Coming from Amman, in the social media conference that His Eminence described, I was there about a week ago, we brought 120 young social media from religious institution. One lesson emerged after the dinner and the first session in the morning. They all were excited to know about each other work, and those were from Syria, Lebanon, Iraq, Jordan, Palestine, and Egypt, and Saudi Arabia. The first thing that they really were impressed by, the fact that they exist, and that they did not know about each other's work. So for us, peace mapping is one about visibility, to prove the fact that there are so many organizations who work on this topic. Visibility is an important aspect for it. Second one is the issue of collaboration. Many of us work in silos, and many of us do lots of work in the conflict area, but do it separately. A very good work, and we're hoping that the peace mapping would be a place, a space, where this possibility of coordination and collaboration will be encouraged. The third point is the capacity building of the interreligious dialogue and peace building field. We notice from Nigeria to Middle East to Central African Republic or Myanmar, where we work in conflict area, there's a great need for capacity building for many of those organizations who tend to be underfunded and marginalized in many of these areas. We're hoping that by mapping their capacities and the challenges they face, we add to the possibility of capacity building. The last point, which is not really it's probably one of the main points here, the issue of impact. Many people argue that, and this is the first thing they'll tell you in conflict area, a religion, if the conflict is not about religion, why do you bother bringing it in the topic? Why do you want to work on interfaith dialogue? It doesn't work. It doesn't help. So this negative starting point in terms of impact, and it's hard to counter. We're hoping by presenting 420 or so organization in phase one that people who doubt the impact and doubt the role that such organization can play will have a second thought before they dismiss the field of interreligious dialogue. Impact and the cumulative impact that we're looking for is maybe one of the major things that we hope in phase two of this project will emerge for it. So again, it's visibility, collaboration, capacity building, and detecting impact or illustrating impact are the four major points I suggest for you to keep in mind while you hear our dear friend and colleague Patrice Prudhoe presenting it for the first time. Patrice?
Your Eminence, Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, it's a tremendous pleasure for me to be here today to see so many of you, and thanks for those who are standing in the back. And I really appreciate your being here today to launch the CAICID Peace Map. We've been working for 2 years, an international team, both at CAICID as well as with other organizations such as the International Peace Institute, Coexiste, based in France, as well as the Harvard Pluralism Project, and I thank all of them for coming together in order to be able to launch today a peace map. As you will see from this peace map, we are trying our best to achieve a number of different aims. And as you open the website, this is the page that you will see, the window that you will see, and it describes those main aims. I'm summarizing them here for you by saying there are three things. First, it's about just the sheer number of organizations that use interreligious dialogue as a methodology, whether or not it's part of their official aims. Two, it's about the breadth of ways in which interreligious dialogue methodology is used in a variety of fields of action, mostly in peace building, broadly defined. Three, it's about providing a space, a platform for interactions, for networking, as people want to engage and collaborate further in doing peace work in the particular areas that is important to their mission. When we look at this website, and what I will do today briefly is a tour de la maison. It's a kind of overview of this website. And so what you start with is a map interface that you can either go slower, whoops, or bigger, but it's interactive. And in that sense, it's adjustable for those of you who may want to use the site on iPads, for example. Of course, there's a traditional search that you can put in your own keywords. And here you'll see the total number of organizations that are part of the directory of interreligious dialogue organizations that is at the heart of this website. If you scroll to the left, you see the legend. And this is where you can find out what the colors of all these dots on the global map represent. There are 11 categories, and this represents a new typology to refine the way in which we think about the different ways, the different areas, the fields in which interreligious dialogue is actually being used on the ground. And if you want more information, you can open a window and get a little more detail as to what we mean by these different 11 categories. If you go back here and to the bottom, you notice that a circle is the headquarters of an organization, and a starred circle is actually a regional office. At the bottom, you can always reset your map. And then there's something very special to this particular website, which I'm very proud of, which is a timeline. Here you will find, chronologically, over 100 years of the founding dates of those 420 organizations that, of course, may not have always used interreligious dialogue back when they were founded, but that are now using it, whether it's in a small way or in a larger way, or whether it's really part of the heart of their mission. Here you will see that there's a whole history, therefore. And if you look at the simple numbers, first of all, you can see their geographical spread, but primarily in two areas, which is North America and Europe. And what you can see is the historical development, especially over the last decade. There's a high concentration of the founding of new organizations that use interreligious dialogue. And that's, I think, a very important fact that now is becoming very clear through this timeline. Now, if we go back to our initial map, you can actually find out information about this in several different ways. One of the ways, for example, is you click on a country. If you take Brazil, for example, you find out that there are several organizations that are interested in doing work in Brazil. They may not have a headquarter or a regional office, but they do activities in that country. And so you simply click on here, and then you have the list of those organizations that are involved in doing interreligious dialogue in Brazil. You want to find out more about, let's take one for example, an Arigato International based in Japan, however far Japan may be from Brazil, is involved in doing work there. And you can find for this organization, and this, by the way, is done for 420 organizations, a detailed information, and I'm going to scroll slowly here so that you can see the different sort of fields that have been developed for all of these different organizations. This is monk and nun works. And you can see that the word Brazil is highlighted in yellow. So this is how you can find out more specifically about this organization's relationship to Brazil and whether it's part of the mission statement or whether it's part of some activities. You can find out this way more specifically as you read more about it. And of course, this information has this window on every organization that one can open will provide you with many more information that you can read. And which languages are being used, their staff, their history, different kinds of reports, their status, and so on and so forth. And at the bottom, you can download this information into your computer, free of charge. So this is, in fact, the case for every organization in the directory. And when you look at the map, you see where the headquarters are, and you can see, well, that was before I went too quickly with my mouse over it, but you could see the green colors were all the countries where Arigato Foundation does interreligious dialogue work. And those lines that you see are simply going from the headquarters to the three regional offices that this organization has. So that's the visualization piece. Okay. If we go now to the right of this website, you have seven tabs. The first one is about general information on how to navigate around the website. The second and the third are about different ways of thinking about the variety of categories that one can think of for the work that is being addressed through a methodology of interreligious dialogue. And I'll get back to show you that in a moment. Then you are three different tabs that are all about linking the activities of interreligious dialogue with their context. And that's what's often missing, and this is what actually we're beginning to provide here. It's only a beginning, it's a phased one. But it really is important to create the connections and the better understanding to see that different kinds of interreligious dialogue activities are responding to very particular concrete situations, often of vulnerability, trying to muster the resources of resilience of faith communities when possible, to better understand how they can address in a collective way through interreligious collaboration the particular issues that they want to address, from violence directly to structural violence to injustices of different kinds. And what's really fascinating about the result of our 420 organizations is that those organizations are focused for the vast majority on concrete action and not just talking in the traditional sense that sometimes is associated popularly to interreligious dialogue. If you go to this first general introduction, you can find here in this particular window more information about how the directory functions, but I want to draw your attention to one particular document, which is really important for those of you who are into research, because it provides the details of the whole methodology behind how we came about empirically collecting this data for this particular website. These are the different sort of chapters of this long document of some 30 pages. I want to just draw your attention on just a few of those. Apart from the description of these 11 different categories, the typology, I want to go and zoom in to the language issues. Is that we actually hired people so that the search was done strictly on websites. So these are all our organizations that are using a website. So if an organization does work internationally but does not have a website, or a website in the 10 languages that we've researched, then it won't appear. And we apologize for this, and we need to continue, of course. But here you have sort of the key words that we use for our search. And then finally, of course, the translation to the best of our abilities. And that's why we have several different words for several of these expressions in different languages. And so we literally had the search done in 10 different languages, with Arabic and with Mandarin. As you see, with Mandarin, it's really complex. And so there, you can see how many different sort of possible ways there are to translate interreligious dialogue or interreligious collaboration. And then, of course, Hindi as well as Russian. So that's part of, I think, the richness of this particular research. If we go back to now the second and third, the areas of action, you can see that to the right-hand side, you have different options here. If you click on any one of them, peace, for example, you will see here the number of organizations that, of course, have peace in their website. That's normal since, of course, most of them are doing peace work. So that's why there's a large number of them. But of course, you could click on any of the others and find out that, of course, several of them are have fewer, several of these words have fewer number of organizations attached to it. And so let me refresh the screen for a moment. And let's look, for example, if we go to forms of action and we look at diplomacy, then you will see, of course, that this is a much smaller number of organizations. But again, the same principle, you type, you click on it, and there goes the list of organizations if you want to know more specifically those who are using this particular approach in their work. Now, if we now focus to the next section, which is all about contextualizing that rich variety of different interreligious dialogue activities, we have identified as a beginning the Human Development Index, that if we click on it, you can actually see appearing the different colors, and we can play with the different factors that are involved in the development of the Human Development Index by UNDP. Of course, we hope to add many more indices in the future. Then there are thematic maps. All of these maps were developed specifically for this particular KAISID peace map, and they tend to be organized in a way that actually covers several years of data, so that they won't go out of date next year simply because we've been using last year's information. Instead, it's a composite of several years that hopefully will be of use for a few years to come. And again, we will add several other of these thematic maps. I'll just show you one for the moment. This is, for example, a map on refugees and internally displaced people. And you can double click on this. Whoops, and that happens a while ago. Then if you double click a second time, then it will open this way. And you can click again in order to be able to actually see better. Okay. So this is the kind of hopefully quality map that we're providing to contextualize the relationship between interreligious dialogue activities, the urgencies to address certain vulnerabilities, such as the internally displaced people and refugees today, when it comes to how interreligious collaboration can foster and help contribute in relieving the source of the problem, as was mentioned by His Eminence, as well as, of course, the immediate relief. Then there is a third concrete and very different kind of information. And this is not statistics. This is about qualitative approach. And this is about giving voices to human beings who are involved in interreligious dialogue on the ground, often locally, and hearing their words about why it's meaningful, and especially what kind of impact it has in their work. And so, for example, we have here several from different continents, Africa, and please, you can see the number of different interviews from the different regions. And if I just sort of open one of them, for example, which we unfortunately won't have time to listen to, you actually have sort of the same format which is being used for all of these interviews. And we're hoping that over the next few years, we can eventually have hundreds and thousands of these personal voices of why interreligious dialogue is important to promote peace.
So having grown with the movement, as it grows, it was something which is, it was only seen during constitutions or riots. You never saw religious leaders come together for something, yeah? But actually we see people trying to solve things interreligiously, which either says some are radical that they can't see face to face with the other side, or some wants to come together and do something. So.
And it continues. All the clips are about 2-3 minutes long. And so they're both individual voices embedded often in organizations with which they work. Finally, in the contact us, you have, of course, the traditional information. But notice at the top, there are a few questions. And this is where we really recognize that our work is at its beginning. And we are very humbled by the fact that we're the tip of the iceberg. And so it's really important to improve the quality of this website. We welcome all of your input orally or especially in writing, that's even better. And we hope to improve quickly this particular platform and making an ongoing evolving website that is interactive and serving as many of your needs as possible for those of you who are engaged in an interreligious dialogue way in the kind of peace building work and other work that you do. In a nutshell, there are 5 takeaways, therefore, that one could think of in conclusion. The first one is the sheer number, 420 organizations. And again, very specifically defined to those that have a website, that have indicated interreligious dialogue or an equivalent term on their website, and that have activities in at least 2 or more countries. So in that sense, we hope that we're pretty exhaustive in the number of organizations we're able to find within those very limited sort of contexts of research and the languages that we have used. The second takeaway is to understand that we have 2/3 of the headquarters of these organizations that are in the North Atlantic region. Yes, that's true, in the north. But when you look at the activities, which is over 6,000 different kinds of events and programs that they are involved in, it's all over the world, all regions, all countries. The third takeaway is that, and this was probably one of our most interesting surprise, only 29% of those organizations self-declare in their website that they are either religious or religiously affiliated. Well, that means that 71% of the other organizations do not, at least officially, say anything about a direct link to religion. And that is really fascinating because it means that interreligious dialogue, at least among this particular segment of 420 organizations, has become more of a means than an end. And secondly, it means that there has already been a huge amount of interaction between governmental and civil society organizations with religious and faith-based organizations in doing this kind of interreligious dialogue activities as a methodology, of which about 80% are focused on peace building, broadly defined. So it's really fascinating to see those results. You can find some of them in the postcards. Some of those statistics that of our research are in those format of postcards that you can pick up in the back if you want. And finally, it's really interesting that if you think about all of this information, it really shows how much we need to better integrate, continue to better integrate religious and faith-based organizations in the efforts of so many governmental at all levels, as well as civil society at all levels, organizations that are promoting peace, in particular, the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development. In closing, I'd like to thank, obviously, all of you for being here today. I'd like to thank the people that are listening through the webcast to this presentation. I'd like to thank in particular the many organizations that have actually responded to our request to make sure that the information that we have about them is accurate to, you know, almost to the day. I'd like to also thank all the collaborators from the International Peace Institute, especially the leadership of Dr. Walter Kemp, who unfortunately couldn't be with us today, as well as, of course, our collaborators, the Harvard Pluralism Project and the Coexister in France, which is a group, I have to say, of young people in their teens and 20s who have done many of these. All of the interviews of the dialogue voices are done by them. And that's important. So we collaborate across generations. And I'd like to, of course, in closing, thank all of my colleagues at CAICID, both here in this room, there's a few of them, as well as back in Vienna, for the tremendous collaborative work that has gone behind the possibility of launching today the CAICID Peace Map. Thank you.
And I think one of the points that Patrice was making at the end is that the need for further integration of interreligious dialogue in different intergovernmental and international organizations. And I think that's a great segue into maybe a comments and reflections from Dr. Karam from the UN Interagency Task Force for Faith-Based Organization. That could be helpful if you let us know what you think about this presentation, data, opportunity. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Professor Abu Nimer, and thank you to the International Peace Institute for the invitation and the opportunity to be here. And congratulations to Dr. Patrice Brodeur, Dr. Abu Nimer, CAICID, and all those who collaborated on this excellent initiative. I very much doubt that there would be any hesitation about the usefulness of this as a remarkable tool. I am very impressed by the five findings that you shared with us, the five takeaways. I think it bears further elaboration why some of the organizations did not even refer to themselves as religious, even though they may be indeed undertaking, and I think that there's plenty to learn from that, but quite apart, frankly, from the mainstreaming of interreligious dialogue as a tool, as a means to an end. I think that there's a couple of things that struck me when I first learned how to use this, and I'm learning, by the way, because I think it takes time to also master it. One of the things that struck me was that the area of education and healthcare, as the Metropolitan was sharing with us, is an area of action and activity that bears consideration in terms of interreligious dynamics. One of the lessons we've learned at the interagency level is that when we're working on health and education, we're not only working on health and education services, we're also working on coexistence and community building, and that some of these very same actors who are very critical service providers or advocacy leaders within their faith communities are all in the area of health and education, are also some of the most critical actors that are reached out to and can play a very prominent role in negotiating certain peaceful resolutions and or tackling some of the conflicts that emerge at the community level. So I would suggest, if I may, that we include some of those areas in the areas of action and activities that you have already included. I was thrilled to see empowerment. I was thrilled to see women's rights. Very often, much of this kind of work doesn't sort of take that into account at all. So I wanted to congratulate you very specifically on that, because it does take certain guts to mention this in relation to religion. And one of the other things I wanted to suggest is the opportunity to look at existing databases, some of which may be more difficult to retrieve because they were, for some reason or other, totally eliminated from the ether. But there was a 500-strong Women of Faith network that Religions for Peace at one point had invested significantly in, and that identified different women's organizations or different organizations that are religious in nature, openly so, that were located around the world, particularly in sub-Saharan Africa, but not only, and the Middle East, who worked through interreligious dialogue on and with a number of different community and related issues. That 500-strong network has disappeared, but there is some traces of it left, if at all possible. Can we consider retrieving some of those voices, as well as experiential narratives, which I think are equally critical and important? And the last thing I'd like to be able to share is that there's a next. I appreciated that you said this is a beginning, and I think that obviously this is a living networking opportunity, and that's a very important thing to add on to. What I'd like to be able to see is more engagement from a number of the different UN agencies who have actors and who have partnerships. We call them implementing partners, we call them advocacy partners, with a number of these different centers and agencies. I think if we could just begin to harvest some of those networks, we would find that this map would increase quite a bit in terms of actors on it. And I'd like to be able to invite you to do that. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Karam, particularly for the recognition that the mapping or the set of data does include reference to women and women empowerment, but also maybe to the point that on the level of a grassroots, you'll find far more presence for women organizations as well as actors in that on that level of action. But that was from the UN. Maybe we can hear from a more civil society groups perspective, Dr. Peterson.
Thank you so much. It's really wonderful to be here and see such a turnout for a presentation about interreligious dialogue. And I'm very excited about the launch of this peace mapping project of CAISED. And for more than 30 years in the interfaith movement, I have become very convinced that there's a pressing need for empirical research and not just conceptualization. And the vision of this project places interfaith work or interreligious dialogue within the larger context where it belongs, of peace building, conflict resolution, intergroup relations of all kinds, and also human development. And the interfaith movement today is a global movement. I could come back later if there's time to what is meant by a movement, but I'm convinced that there are not just thousands, but perhaps tens of thousands of groups, organizations, projects, activities of all kinds throughout the world. And wherever government does not suppress civil society, these groups exist and they are growing. This interfaith movement needs to know more about itself. And why does it? Well, Professor Abu Nimer said most of the reasons already. When groups come together, they exchange information so that they have insight and understanding about what they're doing. The example of the young people engaged in social media was extremely telling, because you said that before they met in the conference, they did not know that each other existed or that they were doing this work. Well, imagine how important that is. So understanding of what we're doing increases, but also skill capacity building is accomplished. Lessons learned, best practices, and the issues that are facing us are extremely urgent. And when we create partnerships may be more effective if there's more skill and capacity building, but the partnership and collaboration may be more effective just if it's bigger. There are more organizations involved. So since I'm involved in interfaith activity for mitigating climate change, ending climate change, we need mobilization on a vast scale. And you can't mobilize unless you know who you're mobilizing. You have to have at least a list of the groups and people that you want to mobilize. You can't just, you know, run it up the flag and see who salutes, as they say. So finally, when we come together, we find spiritual strength in fellowship and celebration, and that also is no small thing. It keeps us going. So I want to commend the virtues and strengths of this of the program for a number of reasons. It's been done on a very we expect this from CAISED, but it's comprehensive because it intends to be comprehensive, systematic, thorough. There's a concern for accuracy, and I know because I was on the receiving end of the checking process for the Parliament of the World's Religions, and I was impressed to know that all these things were being checked. We saw it on your website, and now can you tell us if that's really true? You know, so the structure of the analysis is very sound. And this is based on empirical data, not just suppositions. And the website and the design is so attractive, so lovely. and also user friendly, but it's also designed to display this the analysis, the way the analysis is set up right from the beginning. And it's wonderful to allow each group to say what it means by dialogue. It's a very wise, common sense decision to include all the programs and activities that you can find, regardless of whether the institution itself says we're interfaith and that's our purpose. So otherwise, as I was really, almost startled by what Patrice said about the percentages, that over 70% do not identify themselves as faith-related. So think about how many activities and programs would be left out if a different decision had been made about how to collect the data. And the thematic maps and the interface, the voices of those in the field and the timeline are a wonderful enhancement. I'm all the more excited and happy because this is just the beginning. So as the explanation of the work on the website says, this is still only the tip of the iceberg, and we will broaden this scope in the future to cover national, subnational, and grassroots levels through selected case studies. And I'd like to share an experience that I had in 2003 in the city of Yogyakarta in Java, Indonesia. And I was spending 10 weeks in Indonesia on sabbatical from my college. And I was visiting the program in religious and cross-cultural studies at the University of Gajah Mada, one of the leading universities in Indonesia. And at this center, the level of commitment and sophistication was equal to anything that I had ever found in anywhere else in the world. And being an academic and interested in research, I said, well, do you have interfaith organizations, which they called dialogue groups, here in Yogyakarta? And as I just said, these people are extremely expert. And they said, oh yes, many. So I said, how many? Because I'm, and they, 10, 15. And they said, oh no, more, 30, 40, more. And ever since, I've wanted to go back to Yogyakarta and find out who, what those groups are. And this is a testimony to the strength of the interfaith movement at the grassroots and local level. And coming much closer, in New York, let me give some examples of local interfaith activity in New York that you might not find, that might not have its own website. These are all real examples. Intercongregational dialogue, the Lutheran-Hindu dialogue in Flushing, a monthly meeting of women of Abrahamic traditions, the interfaith arts group in the East Village, and interfaith services that take place at synagogues or churches periodically, all kinds of coalitions on issues. Some will have websites, but some might not. So at a certain point, this, as Patrice said, at a certain point, this research is going to have to go to personal networking, interviews, just a lot of digging and personal contact. And I think that the way it will develop is on a rolling basis with layers and more layers of information. And I'm just thrilled to see this starting with the skill and capacity that has been demonstrated so admirably just now. And so I think that with this kind of research, we will learn the scope of the global interfaith movement in all of its diversity And for reasons that we have been mentioning already, that is going to be a way to strengthen the movement, which is urgently, critically needed to establish peace, justice, and sustainability.
Thank you. Thank you for your comments. In order not to, in order to challenge actually our thinking here, Dr. Pedersen described or mentioned the term field or movement. And this is something very important to think about it, whether people who work in conflict area, in interreligious peace building or dialogue, see themselves as part of a movement. For example, if you think of a Muslim Christian group in Mosul or Kirkuk in Iraq, how much they see themselves as part of a movement in countering or fighting the discourse of ISIS in that area. Or if you want even more related topic, how much of the wonderful work done by interfaith organization in Europe now in order to absorb and help refugees, how much and to what extent these organizations see themselves as part of a field, part of a movement. And maybe that's something for the future. This proposed map, peace mapping, can tackle. And the second one, maybe Patricio can comment on that, is to what extent you're going to go into the national level, because Dr. Pedersen said an example in New York here, and our data set does not relate to that because still in phase one. Any comment? And then I'll open it to some questions.
Absolutely. I think it's very important to understand that the methodology we've used to start needs to be broadened in order to be able to reach down to the rest of the iceberg and discover all of these different sort of ways in which the activities that fall under interreligious dialogue, broadly defined, sort of are. Because the vast majority, of course, are local activities. And the only way that the perception, the awareness of being part from the local to into a global movement and basically sort of muster that energy, that force for resilience today is if there is consciousness that one is part of a whole. And so that's very important, and it is definitely part of our agenda for phase two to move down, if I may put it this way, to the national and eventually to the local, but it will require a very different approach. We can't just use web searches. It doesn't work at that level for the most part. And so that's really a challenge for us at the moment, and we will explore it. And let me just say that part of the thornness of the research, the empirical research, has come from Dr. Carsten Lehmann as on the team, but also who unfortunately is not here with us. There was a technical challenge at the other place where we're presenting later the website. So you had to attend to that. But I'd like to also say that there is Jana Wobeska. Jana, please stand. Because Jana is the person who has put the most amount of time into making this a reality, and she's the expert on all of the methodology. So I just want to thank her personally for her amazing work in this behind the scene of this particular website. Thank you, Jana.
Thank you. Thank you, Patrice. All right. We have about 20 minutes or so. I would love to hear positive things only. and the floor is open for everybody. Yes, one, two, and three.
Thank you very much. Agnès Marcaillou, United Nations. Thank you very much for this excellent presentation. I must say personally, I'm in awe at what you've been able to achieve. It's a humongous enterprise. It's a beginning, and it's got great potential. Now, if I may, I'd like to come back to the actual reason why we are here today, which is how this dialogue can strengthen resilience and contribute to sustainable peace. Fabrice, you said very rightly that this was a means rather than an end. This mapping is the start. We can't really go anywhere without doing a tour de la maison. What I would like to say as a remark is that we need also to ensure that we carry out our responsibility to protect. We are exposing here a number of organizations which are operating in environments that are beyond volatile. And we do not want, with a Western mind and a transparency mind, to actually kill the people that we are trying to help. This takes me to you know, the end of this mapping. We are creating a movement, obviously. This movement is aimed at taking action. There's a whole hierarchy of actions, in my view, that can be taken. And I would like to see as the main one that movement being led by those who have a public voice and who would encourage, enable more followers. I would like to hear the religious leaders. There are many, many religions with leaders that have remained silent in the face of the horrors that we are seeing. The Western media and the Christian leaders like His Holiness the Pope can speak until they turn blue or purple. As long as this message is not carried from within or carried through by the religious leaders where the horrors are being committed, or those who share our fight against extremism, I don't think that we can really go that far. And I would say that in this eve of the General Assembly, if only we could get a declaration, a one page in the Wall Street Journal or in the New York Times, calling, urging member states to comply with international humanitarian law and to curb the arms trade, we would have achieved something. Thank you.
The point is made. I guess two points. One is the how does this contribute to resiliency? And the second one, the assumption that voices and declarations are not made enough and they need to be made more. Dr. Karam, you would like to respond, and Patrice?
Go ahead.
Well, no, I think that actually Patrice is much better equipped to respond to both, but I did want to make a point about the religious leaders coming together and having clear declarations and commitments and so on, and I think there's been quite a bit of that, in fact. And one of the most cynical voices in our own organization, Agnes, has often said repeatedly, and what difference do these religious leaders really do when they speak the way they speak? And we've heard about this frequently. And I think that the question here that renders this particular endeavor very, very helpful and cutting edge is precisely that it shows that it's not simply a question of leadership in communities. It is a question of civic engagement at a mass level that then gets, that you can actually see, and that can then be expanded upon to show that it is beyond, it is inclusive of, but also beyond leadership situations and leadership positions. It is fundamentally a broad movement of organizations, some of which are not even, as you said, many of which don't even acknowledge themselves to be or working in religious, interreligious dialogue. And I think that is one of the many key strengths of this particular mapping that I would urge us to note, because we do very much, as Anya said, need the religious leadership's voices, but we also need the mass movement, the social movement that I think we're missing in this particular century quite a bit. And it's extremely helpful to see that on a map, so to speak. But one more point I'd like to share, which is to underline what Anya said in terms of what danger do we put those organizations in, if any. And I think that point needs to be taken a little bit more seriously on board, precisely because we do have contexts where those risks, who do this work take certain risks. So I just think that question needs to be very seriously dealt with. Yes, thank you, Agnes, for raising it.
Thank you. Would you like to comment?
Yes, I'd just like to underscore what Aza said. It's not just the leaders who can affect change. People sometimes or often don't pay attention to high-ranking leaders. But the point that I'd like to make briefly is local organizations, local interfaith dialogue is extremely important because it can build close, solid relationships because people meet often. There's a great difference between meeting once a year and meeting once a month or even once a week. And those kinds of relationship building encounters are happening all over the world, and that's where I'll just give one example from this area. There was a Jewish congregation on Long Island that felt a need to meet their Muslim neighbors, And they reached out until they found Muslims who would meet with them often. And they met in each other's homes, you know, once a month. And finally, this led to the founding of the Long Island Multi-Faith Forum. Mm-hmm. And they went, as dialogue groups do all over the world, they started with things which were a bit easier to talk about, and they moved on to the very difficult things. And when 9/11 happened, they were ready.
Thank you. That relationship on a local level built the fabric.
They had the relationship.
Just a quick note. Qaisid alone, as His Eminence mentioned, did already three major declarations, the Vienna, the Athens, and Beirut, all these largest declarations with the highest level of religious leader. You can see them on the website. And also we gathered, I myself with assistant from Qaisid, over 78 declarations has been made by, to name it, Muslim religious leader in the region against ISIS and the discourse. In fact, as Dr. Azza said, there's a plenty of those declarations, and hopefully we're moving more into the action. Yes, please.
Yes, I'm Dr. Yael Danieli of the International Organization of Victims Assistance.
Yes.
And I'm a psychologist by profession and a trauma specialist. And I'm wondering, in our work, in psychosocial work on the ground, on building resilience, we call it healing. We have our own set of wording and our own set of how to frame what we are doing. Religion, of course, always comes in because most conflicts involve religious conflicts, such as in South Africa, such as in the former Yugoslavia, and I don't need in this audience to speak about that. I wonder how much you want to acknowledge that and to reach out, because your framework is wonderful. It's like I was totally fascinated, and I'm going to study it. But I want to know whether the psychosocial aspect, which really must be there to augment the interreligious, is clearly acknowledged, whether the psychosocial expertise we have and the work on resilience, the scientifically based work on resilience, is involved.
Thank you.
And the other dimension I want to say, because we are talking about the multidimensional issue, not just one, is the media, the involvement of the media in as a partner.
Yes,
be it on the religious leadership or be it just covering, you know, these kind of meetings in Long Island and just a little bit to add more, how about traditional healing? When you say religion, what level of religions
do
you respect and
do
you include? Because we find that if you do not involve the traditional or indigenous practices, you're missing the boat, especially with those people you want to reach, which is on the ground.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Patrice, yes?
Just 2 points to respond to at least 2 parts of the many points you raised, very important ones. The first one is that on the question of the relationship between religious leaders and the media, we had a forum, a consultation that took place for 2 days in Paris back in mid-June, where we actually come out with a set of recommendations as well as a way to empower Qaisid and other organizations that want to actually do training of religious leaders, broadly defined, as well as a variety of different leaders of media. Again, broadly defined, so that they can mutually train each other, if I may say, about their respective worlds in a dialogical way, because that's really the most transformative possibility, because there tends to be very misperceptions about each other's worlds. So these are so we have the manual, we have sort of we're beginning to put in place sort of more of those seminars, and we need to put them online and so on and so forth. So that's, for example. But that's not directly related as such to the peace map. What is important, though, is when you think about healing, I think one of the ways in which we know now that healing can take place is by combining evidence-based information and narrative, personal stories that are so powerful. When you combine the two, you can actually get people on their own to figure out how to help heal themselves. And it needs to be facilitated and so on and so forth, but at least the peace map provides, or will hopefully provide even more in the future, that kind of evidence-based information that cannot just dismiss the fact that interreligious dialogue is a powerful tool. There are many tools, but that's one that we need to acknowledge as part of how human beings can actually build resilience. In one way is through develop and foster collaboration in that way. And the people that are traumatized in one way or another, or are the survivors through generations of traumas from the past, the process of healing needs to take into account sort of this kind of information that comes out of the peace map, at least in its first phase, and hopefully more with your help in the future. So thank you.
Patrice, there was one more point, and I know you've been asked about this. To what extent those 420 organizations recognize the role of the traditional leaders, indigenous different forms of spirituality are represented here? Are these projects also part of this?
If they are not using interreligious dialogue or an equivalent interfaith dialogue or interfaith collaboration, you know, then they would not appear here. But again, I mean, you know, this is a beginning. So we had to be as narrow as possible to be as exhaustive as possible with what we chose to focus on. That's the strength, right? But of course, now we have to enlarge.
Thank you. And Ambassador Ofuk from the OIC is here, and he's also a founding member of the Network for Traditional and Religious Leader for Peacemakers as well. And you can also hear more from him after the session about the inclusion, the intentional inclusion of that. Yes, please.
Richard Jordan from the Royal Academy of Science International Trust. Kusumito, always good to see you. Two very quick points. The value of an interfaith calendar that delineates the religious holidays of all faith traditions is very valuable. There was a one in Vancouver, the Interfaith Calendar Committee. The UN Environment Program Interfaith Partnership created one as well. Great tool for solidarity and to be able to greet your brother and sister on their special day. And lastly, coming from Flushing, New York, I must bring up the Flushing Remonstrance, which 358 years ago guaranteed religious freedom of worship in New Amsterdam. And its last operative paragraph even welcomes, it says, even people from Turkey and Egypt.
Even.
So 358 even. Years ago, Flushing, New York. Thank you.
Even.
So even from Turkey and Egypt was included. Good. So let's take a few more. Yes, one and two and three and four and five and six and seven. But again, brief, and we still have about 12 minutes, and I promise you the response will be brief. So you have the pressure of having another eight people behind you.
I love
it.
Go
ahead.
Okay, so my name is Tony Woodruff from Noise Boys Entertainment, and I was born in Trinidad, in a place where we have all kinds of interfaith ceremonies.
It's true.
And I would love to see that happen all over the world. Just one suggestion, you could just call anybody from Trinidad, we'll tell you how it's done, mostly through food. And the second thing is, I am a songwriter, music producer, audio expert, and I'm a man of action, so do call me, and only call me if you're ready to have anything like a PSA, theme music, any sort of audio work, post-production, anything done that's connected to this, I would love to volunteer.
Thank you. We'll take the next one. Yes, ma'am, yeah, go ahead.
Thank you. Yvonne Duarte Pena, United Nations. My question is, within your research, you mentioned that 80% approximately of those institutions that are working in the interreligious dialogue devote themselves to conducting peace building. Is there other 20% focused on mediation, for instance? Or I'm interested particularly on their participation in the peace processes, as such. And then just very briefly, touching upon something you said, is there any prospect for perhaps assessing the impact of the training that you conduct? I know that's, I think, the second year of your training. How can you measure that those who participated in your training are actually participating afterwards in peacemaking efforts, particularly mediation of violent conflicts? Thank you.
Thank you. Let me take one more at least, and then we can respond. Yes, ma'am, go ahead.
Thank you very much. So, is this working?
Yes.
Thank you very much. I want to congratulate you for your presentation. I found it excellent. I'm Rebecca Rios Cohn. I'm with Arigato International. Thank you very much for showing our page. I just wanted to add that we will really welcome your mapping, because in our work, and we're creating a social movement to promote interfaith dialogue for the well-being of children worldwide. And this is a Herculean effort, as you can imagine. And we are fortunate to be growing and to be able to say that we have made some extraordinary progress with limited resources, but with through partnership. So I would say that this kind of partnership is essential, and I'm excited to see this because I think that we can be very optimistic in the future. And lastly, I would say that the way we are working now is to be as aware of the global issues as possible and to be in that dialogue at the global level, which I think you are very much a part of that, but to also be relevant at the local level. And we do that through our actions, how minimal they may seem, because the outreach is still sometimes extraordinary with one activity of interfaith dialogue that can be a catalyst for many other activities. So I think there's a need and an interest out there to support this sort of thing in all the regions where we are working.
Thank you.
So thank you very much.
Thank you. Yes, please. Go ahead, ma'am.
Hi, thank you for an excellent panel and rollout. My name is Grove Harris with the Temple of Understanding, and I'm interested in expanding your work into the second and third phase and thinking about expanded definition of conflict, which would include human rights abuses, the shrinking of space for civil society, and people who are frontline defenders against environmental devastations. And so I'm wondering how that definition, that broadening, might be able to be served by your work. Thank you.
Thank you. Maybe we can take a couple of responses.
Let's finish the pictures and then...
No problem. Please, go ahead. So you're taking
notes. Good afternoon. My name is Doguje. I'm with the World Interfaith Alliance. And I'm happy to see the proposal by the King of Saudi Arabia. Am I correct? And because the Middle East, and in particular, the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia is associated with sponsoring terrorism all over the world. I'm from Nigeria, and we have a religious crisis for the past like a decade. And some quarters in the country, some very political segments of the country have linked the terrorism we're experiencing with Saudi Arabia for whatever reasons, you know? So my question is very simple. How do you use interreligious dialogue to deal with terrorism?
Thank you. That's a simple question you said.
That's the only question I have. And also, how are you trying to use the same interreligious dialogue to address ISIS?
Thank you.
All right.
Thank you. I think we still have one or two. Yes, go ahead.
Ted Perlmutter, Columbia University. I teach a course on conflict and social networks, and a program in negotiation and conflict resolution. And my questions are somewhat methodological, but I think they're broader. And those are, it would be interesting to see what a social network analysis looked like, not just a geographic mapping, to sort of see who really are the central actors. And the second thing I would encourage you to do is actually do a project-based analysis. When I've taught this stuff and looked at this, I found that if you actually get down to the project level, you get much better data, and you have perhaps a greater capacity to build interactions between various groups.
Thank you. Great. So we had the eight comments. I think five of them at least questions. And we'll start with how do you do assessments? I think assessments.
Do you want me to go backwards, or do we want to respond?
As you wish. If you want to take the lead,
yes,
and then
please.
Maybe Azza and Dr. Peterson
maybe
can
respond then.
Yeah, go ahead.
Is that okay?
Whatever.
Yeah, okay, fine. So let's go backwards, which sometimes happens when we have a list of questions and comments. Definitely. I think that the last comment about the methodology and the need to do research that is more project-based, linked to assessment criteria and to be able to really measure impact is really important. I believe that this is where we're going in terms of enlarging. When I mentioned enlarging our methodology, eventually it has to go in the direction of empowering people about M&E and monitoring and evaluation, and with them construct the reporting mechanism that can then enable to measure the impact that then becomes evidence-based information about the degree of success and of impact of the work. This is long-term. I mean, this is not easy to develop, but at least I think we have sort of the framework and the willingness to go ahead in this direction. So I just want to say that that this is really the social networking and who are the actors. My dream one day is to be able to actually have the names of everybody that are in those different organizations and how they met and where and what and who signed which declarations and did what kind of projects funded by whom and so on and so forth. Well, that's a big dream. But eventually, this is the long term that I think that this peace map is just beginning to move towards. And so thank you for that input. Then the question about how do we use interreligious dialogue to counter extremism? It is by actually make it more and more and more public and easily accessible. These joint declarations, united against religion in the name of united against violence in the name of religion. This kind of information needs to be common knowledge on more popular levels. Most people don't know about these efforts. How do we bring it down to the local, to the different local realities, especially where there is a tremendous amount of increase in the kind of violence that we know is reported on? That is part of the work of interreligious collaboration on the grassroots. And so being sort of, I think that part of what KAIS's mission is to be a link, to help sort of enable the transmission of some of these activities, whether they are done by us or by many, many other organizations that have actually already done much of this work. Another element has to do with the importance of human rights as one of the criteria in the work. The way we go about it is not to focus on human rights per se. The focus is on interreligious dialogue, recognizing those organizations and individuals who work through the methodology of interreligious dialogue to address human rights issues or environmental issues, more broadly speaking. And so that's, I think, sort of the difference here. The emphasis is different, but I think that we can work together because the aims, the long-term aims and values behind those efforts are the same. And so I think that that's what I would say. Of course, Rebecca, you're the lucky one to have been shown sort of more directly. So congratulations for winning the prize this today. But also for reminding us of how do we make this work relevant at the local level. And that, I think, is important. Yvonne mentioned sort of peace building versus mediation. That's why I said peace building broadly defined, because in that sense, we would include mediation. Again, it goes back often on definition of terms, and we can argue back and forth, but in this sort of general introductory sort of framework, I didn't go into definitions because that's another story. But I do believe it's important, though, to still nevertheless take into account these issues. And I think the last piece was about Trinidad and the beautiful sort of ways in which interactions take place. That, of course, is part of the grassroots genius. That is a long-term part of the human resiliency that we need to have more stories about through the dialogue voices and beyond. Thank you.
Thank you. Azad, would like to comment?
Just a couple of points to say that I think that the value of monitoring and evaluation and of measuring impact cannot be overstated. However, I also think that we do not need to reinvent the wheel in some respects, because I think if you look at the framework of the SDGs alone, and this is only but one framework, there's 169 indicators for each of the different areas. And I'm figuring there's a few indicators there already under the peace and peaceful societies. And I think if we could use some of those existing indicators to simply showcase where the work of interreligious dialogue on a faith-based organizations features and can be counted and included, I think the emphasis needs to go on that rather than on retraining and redeveloping and new indicators and whatever, which, by the way, we all love to do, but I'm just saying it would probably not be necessary too much to do that. Quick comment on the point about how we counter terrorism with interreligious dialogue. I think once we get into the national level more deeply and we begin to look particularly at the work of a number of different organizations, umbrella organizations, some of them of different religious groups. Andrew Tomlinson from the Quakers was here. I don't see him anymore, but some of those groups, ACT Alliance, Those are the kinds of umbrella groups that bring together a tremendous range of local experience and expertise in dealing with some very, very, what you would call raw development issues, poverty, inequality, social injustice, et cetera, health, education. And it is through that, and I bring that point consistently because I think we always tend to focus on the meta, the religious leaders, the peace building, the mediation. Realistically, in terms of service provision, at the very basic community level, we will find that actually some of these very basic service providers are some of the most active peacemakers in the literal sense of the word, that communities know. And the extent to which we can look at their engagement, I'd like to be able to boast about UNFPA Kenya country office, the engagement on youth, bringing them together from religious communities to talk about maternal health, for heaven's sake. Maternal health. I mean, why would maternal health be relevant to peace building? Actually tremendously relevant, because they came together across different religious communities to make a common case and realize that they could also work together with these same youth networks to help them move away from the potential attractiveness of rhetoric such as that of ISIS. It's really very simple, very straightforward, and sometimes rather disingenuous, but that's the truth of it. And that's why I think it's extremely important to focus on those kinds of activities and not simply look at the lofty idealism of those who are mediators and peacemakers. Look at those who are providing food, nutrition, health, sanitation. There are your local religious actors who are doing a tremendous amount of work and working together across religious India. That's it.
Thank you. Thank you. Would you like to comment if you...
Yes, a different kind of assessment. We're asking about assessment of interreligious dialogue to build peace. I'd just like to talk about the assessment of the research itself in giving an empirical account of the global interfaith movement. So I have proposed here and there a specific criterion, which is any ongoing activity that intentionally or deliberately includes more than one religion should be counted as a part of the movement. And so my question is, in a given region or at a given level, what percentage of the activities that actually exist have we captured? And then you could correlate that with tolerance, social cohesiveness, and so forth. And that has been my dream for some years, and I'm so excited that some other people are interested in this civil society research, because when I say the importance of research, sometimes people just like, you know, it's not exciting. About indigenous peoples, I would say interfaith organizations per se. This has been something that has evolved since the 1970s. And today, in interfaith programs, I think there is a very conscious effort. Of course, it really depends very much on the geographical setting, to involve indigenous participants in interfaith programs. And that means indigenous not simply as an ethnicity, but people who are practicing their inherited traditional indigenous religions. And my estimate is that there are something like 400 million people in the world today who are practicing their traditional indigenous religions, although they might also be nominally practicing some, double belonging. Practicing across boundaries is common today, and it's certainly common for indigenous peoples. I think that inclusiveness is making a great deal of progress.
Thank you.
And some of us have really worked hard for years on that.
Thank you. Thank you again for covering that. Dialogue is not about avoidance. It's about confronting the issue. And I hate for you to leave without getting an answer to the Saudi thing that the person have. I'm not sure if you're still here. Are you? He left. Okay. But in general, I'm interested in responding to that. The center indeed holds the late King Abdullah name, and also in its first 3 years funded primarily by the donation from Saudi Arabia, but also hosted by the Austrian government, and as a host also contributed that, and also the government of Spain is also included, and the Vatican as well, a member of that. So it's a four-state entity, intergovernmental. It's not really a only Saudi center, as was implied there. The second point I wanted to mention is that even if the association was made in the question that terrorism and Saudi Arabia, I would say, even if that assumption is accurate for him, I would say we need to embrace the fact that the king put his name on an initiative of this sort, reached out to the Pope in 2007, and this collaboration produced this initiative that aims to bring the positive role of the religious leader in linking or working with policymakers. That's something that does not exist today in the world, where we bring religious leaders and institution with policymaker. An experiment like that is indeed being supported by the government of Saudi Arabia, and I think this is the primary function and purpose of it, regardless what the perception of some or the person who asked the question. But here we go. You get also an official response to it. Thank you all for staying with us, and appreciate your questions. And please feel free to see the website as well. Thank you all.